sometime Sunday morning I stumble from my bed, afraid of what the mirror might say to me. Memories of you so strong, a classic case of love gone wrong. Maybe someday, well, I'll get it right. Somewhere in Kentucky, there's a man who's feeling lucky, sleeping with a woman that once was mine.
So you were in New York, and then you went to Texas, mm-hmm. and you met Bubba Hudson and Ron Daly. And talk to us about that story.
Okay. At the time.
And how the naming of the Greg Austin Band came about.
Oh, that's a cool story, too. I was playing with Pat at the time, which was a Kingston Trio knockoff, if you will, and a little bit more. We did some Kingston Trio songs. We were doing songs about the band, and had a banjo and a guitar and a bass, so you can imagine it wasn't really too rock and roll. But Pat, whether you liked him or disliked him, he could entertain Eskimos. He was one of the best entertainers in the world. And we were playing in a place called the Railhead in Houston. They had one in Dallas, too, but we started off in the one in Houston, which is like a big dinner club-like thing. Had a great theater, and you could go in there and eat and then come out and sit in the theater. It's kind of an amphitheater-type deal. We'd stay there a month and go to Dallas for a month, and we'd just do back and forth for a while, and then we'd go somewhere else. But in the time, we'd get done. We'd go from 9 to 12 in those days at that bar, and so I'd had time to go out and meet some people. And one of the managers at the bar was named Ron Daly. He took me to see Bubba play. Bubba was in a band called Me and Paul, and his bass player was named Paul, and he just like the Willie song. But anyway, I was fascinated with Bubba. He's a real talent, and Ron was good too. And they came back to Kentucky with me, and we started on this after years of being down there. But in the long run, Bubba and Ron both came back and lived with me and my grandmother for years, and that was when the GAB started. And you know, I was telling Stacy, you can ask anybody. There might be somebody who was in our band at one time that didn't like me personally, or didn't like my music, or didn't like my style. That's fine and dandy. Matter of fact, I wouldn't be a bit hurt or surprised either way. But you can't find anybody that worked any harder than that particular bunch of guys, Ron and Bubba, and Chris Nieto played drums, and Howard played bass until we got Ray. When Ray joined the band, things really got hopping, because he could add harmony parts that nobody else could. He had a good harmony thing. And
we are speaking of Ray.
Ray Adams, I'm sorry. Yes. And I thought everybody knew that. But when we got here, Bubba was real excited. Bubba was kind of the music director at that time. And then actually, when Bubba left and David came in, it kind of went over to me and Ray as kind of the band directors. And but anyway, Bubba, they were in town. We were rehearsing every day with different guys. And we said, we better get a name. And I was throwing out Elkhorn Creek and all this crap. And Bubba said, there's no question about the name. He said, it's going to be called the Greg Austin Band. I said, well, I don't want my name, you know, on this. And he said, I've been here for 3 months, and everywhere I go, every person I talk to knows your name. I said, you're kidding. But he must have, I don't know, but he said, it's going to be called the Greg Austin Band, or I'm going back to Texas. And Ron said the same thing, so that's what we called it.
So the introvert, right, was trying to avoid having his name on the title, and this happened. To me, it was a great marketing move.
He knew
your name in this area.
Yeah. And that's for a guy who never left Texas. So that was pretty good.
So you played at the Steak and Ale?
Started out, I played Steak and Ale with Pat and Nick. I don't think we ever played there with the GAB. I know we didn't, because they couldn't fit us on the stage. That was a small stage. But, we started out the Lost Armadillo, which ended up being the Upstart Crow and all that. And it was at the Lost Armadillo that we met some people from Texas who wanted to open a bar and have us be the featured band there all the time. And they asked me what they wanted to call the bar. And I said, well, let's call it Joe Bob's Bar or something. They said, no, we're going to call it Austin. Because it was kind of a double thing. You know, if they use the word Austin, it's Texas. But the name, the Greg, and so they called it Austin City Saloon. I wanted to call it Austin City Limits, but they couldn't do that because it was already one of them things in Texas. And but anyway, Austin City Saloon was established from the Lost Armadillo because of Bubba and Ron. They were Texans, and we were doing a lot of Texas music.
And so now you not only have your band named Greg Austin, but now you have a bar named after you.
Damn, I never even thought of it that way, but you're right. It's kind of, and for a guy who's
an introvert.
Yeah, genius. Christian, what was I thinking?
So I'm trying to, like, in my mind, trying to line up what was going on culturally, and was this around the time of Urban Cowboy,
exactly.
Perhaps?
Yeah.
And was line dancing in play at that time, or was it starting to become a thing?
Yeah.
I'm thinking that kind of was more towards the end of the 80s, but
no.
Urban Cowboy was very much out, I think.
1980, I think.
Yes. Yeah.
1980 or 81.
So there was a huge interest in country music.
Exactly.
Even from people that weren't normally interested
exactly.
in country music.
Exactly. One of the neatest things in Texas, I'd never seen it before, was go to these, I hate anything, I don't like disco because you're cutting musicians out of the thing, just putting on a record. But anyway.
That was also at play.
Exactly. Yes. And my first album, I got a big shirt that says Disco Sucks across the front. But anyway, you'd see these beautiful Texas women, and there'd be 50 of them, and they'd be all out there doing this dancing thing, you know, and it's like, God, you know, it's so cool. And then they do the Cotton Eye Joe, and then they do the Shottish, and it was all of them just looked perfect, and I was going, man, this is cool. And so when we got back to Kentucky, you know, we were playing two-steps, we were just doing Texas songs, and we did the Cotton Eye Joe, which I think probably was the first time that anybody had heard that who had never left Kentucky. I mean, so yeah, and then Urban Cowboy came out, and it was just like Katie barred the door, you know. It was really hot for a while.
So is this the timing of around 1979, 1980, when the bar opened?
Yes. Everybody says it was 1980, and maybe it was, but I remember hammering on some wood and watching a little TV, and it was talking about Mount St. Helens erupting, mm-hmm. which was 1980.
Yes.
So
here's your history coming up.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. So maybe it was... maybe that was just the process of I don't know how long we were before they bought it. I had 10% of it. And all I did was book bands, ourselves and other people. I didn't do anything else. And so it was around 80 or 81. People say it was 81. I think it was probably 80, but that's the name of that. So.
And who were the owners that you were in partnership with?
One of my oldest friends, Kathy Paxton. She was married to Gary Paxton, and I'd known Kathy since I was six. And I had a crush on her, you know. She was like 4 years older than me, you know, so, you know, that is. And Vern and Marilyn Doobie, who were from New Hampshire, actually. And there was five of us all together, and like I said, I had a small 10% of the bar. But my job was to do the music and stay the hell out of their way, which I did.
So you all packed the house, and then eventually you would go on the road back and forth, right?
Mm-hmm.
And New England, New York, and then you'd come back to Austin City Saloon.
Right.
So when you went on the road, Austin City perhaps became famous for showcasing some young and upcoming talent
mm-hmm.
while you all were gone.
Yep.
And John Michael Montgomery was one of these people.
Correct.
So talk about the role of John Michael Montgomery at Austin City Saloon.
Okay. He got in kind of the tail end of my association with Austin City. But it seems like every Saturday there, the last couple of years, he'd sit, I couldn't see him now, sitting over in his corner. And John at the time was very slender and, you know, very handsome guy. He couldn't touch Troy, but anyway... he'd sit over there and he'd just wait for me to call him up. He'd get up and do two or three songs and get down, and he did that, I don't know. I don't know exactly how long he did it, but he did it for a while, and he was good. And now Eddie was always, in my mind, a really good singer, and he was a good drummer, too. And, of course, when him and Troy got together, he didn't play an instrument anymore. But I remember we came back from New Hampshire one time. We had it down pretty good because we played up there so much. We'd leave there around 2 at night, 2:30, drive straight through, and we'd get home about between 6 and 9 on Sunday night. So we'd, you know, instead of getting up the next morning, driving back over here, we just went right to Austin City and started unloading our stuff. We had a big 25-foot truck. So we started unloading our stuff, and John is there unloading his stuff because I'd booked his band while we were gone. I think the band was called Early Times Band, which is kind of, anyway, that was my drink, Early Times, at the time. But anyway, so we got all of our crap unloaded, which took about an hour, and John had given us these big posters his girlfriend had made up. They were about this big, literally, real good posters. And we helped John get his stuff in the van, or his trailer. And so, you know, once he got his band, whether it was Eddie with him or whoever, you know, he played there a lot after I left. I think we sold, Kathy sold it in either 88 or 89 maybe, or 90. I don't really remember. We had a pretty good run there. From 81 to late 80s. I don't know exactly how long, but a guy came in and named Jack and took over, and Jack was good friends with all the young guys at the time. And I think he had Eddie and Troy and John. Well, no, Troy wasn't with him at the time. Troy was kind of with us, but he got John in there a lot. So.
And Troy Gentry performed at the time where you owned the saloon.
Well, I was still playing there. It was the night that the first night I met Troy was, that I remember, was the night that, who's the real pretty guy with the beautiful hair? Bon Jovi.
Oh.
He was playing at Rupp. And it was, I swear, with no cell phones or anything like that, it like within an hour, there were people everywhere. And it was unbelievable. And then I think he played there that weekend, and nobody knew it was actually Troy that was in Austin City at the time. And he signed autographs for like 2 hours, you know. And I don't know what he signed, whether it was Troy or Richie Sambora, but that was our first relationship. And he went on the road with us. And I remember his wife, or his mother, Pat, came to my house the first time he went out with us. And she grabbed me and said, "Greg, please take care of my little boy. Please take care of my little boy. He's so young." So I did, but Troy didn't need no help from me. I know that. he was the most handsome man I'd ever seen it live. I mean, he was a handsome man at 19. Well, he still was, but at 19 he was a handsome man. So you can imagine being in New Hampshire or Vermont, and he's walking around. You know, I said, "Damn."
So did you enjoy a friendship with Troy?
Yes.
Throughout his life?
Yeah. And, well, till I think the second or third album, he used to call me like at least once a month and, you know, ask me some things. And then I'd say, "How's it going?" He'd tell me what's going on, you know. And it was about the time he had that incident with the bear that he quit calling. And, of course, I never did bother Troy at all. I never asked him for anything or bothered him at all. I'd wait for him to call me, and he just quit calling. I knew what had happened. He, you know, started listening to some people he shouldn't have listened to. And, you know, people are so ornery. If they know the tricks, they can get to anybody, you know. And he started listening to the wrong people, it's just not right. I'd give anything if I could have been around him at that time. You know, I could have kept him away from some of that crap, you know. But, and I think the accident, you know, I don't know what the deal was there, but I know if I was around then, he wouldn't have gotten that damn helicopter. I know that, but I don't know. I said, it's a tragedy, and I don't think I'll ever get over that in some ways, you know. He was a good man.
On my mind, she's so fine. Haven't seen her for a while, she said. don't kill me. Cause the hooker in Philadelphia stole it. She needed more than me. Now there's a lesson to be found in Philadelphia town. I'll be rolling home. I'm Kentucky bound. I've got this lady on my mind. She's so fine. I've seen her for a while. She saved the Lord, love it just for me. I'm Kentucky.